All right, good morning. Good, and how are you? Fine, good. Okay, today we're going to continue with history. It's lesson five. Lesson five starts with question one, which is, when did the Japanese start wearing Western clothes? And I first want to hear your answer, and then let's see what happens, okay? So, you want to begin? Okay, thank you.
Western clothes were first introduced during the Meiji period. Meiji period started in 1868,
okay.
And it was a time when Japan heavily influenced by foreign cultures.
Okay.
And the government encouraged people to adopt Western clothing and habits. At first, government officials and military personnel, as well as mailmen and railroad workers, were required by law to wear the Western style uniforms. And Western clothes gradually became common among people. And once its popularity became gaining during the World War II, and later became popular and nationwide again, World War II.
Okay, after World War II. Okay, good. Not bad. That's pretty good, actually. Just in your answer, Japan was heavily influenced.
Japan was heavily influenced.
Right. Okay, good. That's pretty good. And then after World War II, especially, or I'm not sure you mentioned World War II, right? And I think
I said once its popularity became gaining during World War II.
Okay.
During wars, I should say.
Well, my impression, I thought it more after the war.
More after.
Like the wearing of Western clothes became more popular after World War II.
Mm.
Not during the war, no? Was it during the war?
I thought its popularity gaining its popularity.
Okay, wearing Western clothes was gaining popularity.
Wearing Western clothes became gaining popularity.
Let's see, wearing Western clothes. Wearing Western clothes gained popularity.
Wearing Western clothes gained popularity.
Yeah.
During World War II.
Okay.
And that it became nationwide again after wars.
Okay, so wearing Western clothes gained popularity during World War II and especially after.
Especially after it became nationwide again.
Yeah, nationwide. We became popular throughout the nation.
Oh, it became popular throughout the nation.
Right. When you said again, I'm not sure what was there a time when it wasn't popular? I think you said again. It was gained popularity after the war again. Did you say again? No. Okay. Okay. All right. Good. That's pretty good. Okay. I just thought that after the war, especially, wearing Western clothes gained popularity. Okay. Good. In this answer, they mention the word mailmen, and even though at the time of the Meiji period it was more likely only men that brought the mail, but it sounds a little bit outdated today because there are, you know, women who bring mail.
Mm.
Maybe not in Japan so much, but in other countries. So we usually say postal workers, just like you have here, railroad workers. So it sounds nicer to say postal, P-O-S-T-A-L, workers. Okay, and you could say government workers, that's fine, or just, you know, simple words. They have officials, government officials, or, you know, government workers, railroad workers, postal workers started to wear Western clothes, and military people started to wear Western clothes as uniforms.
Mm-hmm.
And all of them actually wore Western clothes as uniforms. Okay, good. Let me have you answer the same question. When did the Japanese start wearing Western clothes?
Well, it was the, at the Meiji Restoration. The Meiji Restoration.
Okay.
The government ordered military persons to wear the Western style clothes.
Clothes. Okay.
In addition to that, mailmen or postal workers and other governmental officials forced to wear the Western style clothes.
Okay. Were forced to wear. Huh? Were forced to wear. Were, W-E-R, were forced to wear.
Oh, war. War forced.
To wear. Uh-huh. Okay.
War forced.
No, were, I think you said government workers forced to wear is what you said. Huh? And you need to say government workers were, W-E-R, were forced to wear.
The government
workers were forced.
Not wore, W-O-R-E,
not like wear the clothes. No, were is the past tense of to be. Were.
Were. W-E-R-E.
Yeah. Okay. So the verb forced. Has to be passive, and so you need to say were forced.
I said was.
Yeah. I don't think you just said the government workers forced to wear. You didn't say, so I was trying to correct the grammar.
Okay, thank you.
All right, good. Okay.
Well, forced to wear the Western style clothes.
Okay.
And this, because many government officials and workers wore the Western style clothes, the common people also came to wear the Western style, so it's a style. It became kind of fashion and spread out across Japan.
Okay, good. All right, good. I think the idea is that it spread out throughout Japan, but it didn't happen overnight. We say it didn't happen all at once. The government workers, postal workers, railroad workers. Started to wear, and I think when the first female workers who wore Western clothes were nurses, and I heard of but bus conductors, and so it gradually took time for everybody to more or less wear Western clothes. So it didn't happen that everybody, you know, one day started wearing Western clothes. Okay. So that's just something you can say. So eventually it became more and more popular. That's why, especially after the war, you know, necessarily like nowadays, you rarely see so many people wearing Western clothes. Usually people going to tea ceremony or maybe a wedding or something. But, you know, just to put on your clothes and go shopping, people don't wear kimono usually. Maybe Oba-chan still does. Okay, you know what I want to do? I'd like you to try this again because I kind of fixed it and stopped you. And I'd just like to hear it again. After listening to you know what we've talked about, okay, let's just practice this one more time. Okay, when did Japanese start wearing Western clothes?
Okay, it was at the Meiji Restoration. Just after that, the government forced to wear the Western style clothes for. Governmental officials, workers, and also military men, and including mailmen. So it's seeing that the common people gradually started to wear the Western style clothes, and. Especially after the Second World War, people wore the Western style clothes instead of kimono more and more. Mm-hmm. And now almost all people, 99% of Japanese, wear Western style kimono instead of Western style clothes、mm. instead of Japanese style kimono.
Right. So nowadays, who wears Japanese style clothes? What kinds of people?
Oh,、small wrestler.
Okay.
And shrines, the monks in temples.
Right. The shrine people or the shrine people priest, and monk, Shinto priest and
Shinto priest and temples priest.
Okay.
And in some occasion, like wedding ceremony and funeral, they、okay. wear kimono.
Right. Wedding ceremonies and funerals, they wear kimono. Okay. Good.All right, just again, about the forced. So the government forced, you know, railroad workers, military people to wear Western clothes. The railroad workers, the government workers, the postal workers were forced to wear Western clothes by the government.
Were forced.
Yeah. So either way.
Either way.
But the government forced them to wear Western clothes, or those people were forced to wear Western clothes. Okay, there's different ways you can say.Okay, let me ask you again the same question. When did Japanese start to wear Western style clothes?
Western clothes were first introduced during the Meiji period. Meiji period started in 1868, and it was a time when Japan was heavily influenced by Western culture and culture.
Yeah, well, either way, cultures is fine.
Because cultures. The government encouraged people to adoptWestern clothing and habits. At first, government workers and military people, as well as post workers and railroad workers, they were required by law to wear Western style uniforms. Western clothes gradually became common among people, but wearing Western clothesGained popularity once during World War II, but especially after the war, it became popular again throughout the nation.
Right. Okay. Probably it became more popular.
Became more popular
throughout the nation. So don't say maybe again doesn't work. Okay. Good. Could you tell me this? Just answer the same question. He mentioned some people who wear Japanese clothes still.What kinds of people wear Japanese clothes today?
Most Japanese today wear kimonos only on special occasions such as their New Year holidays, formal occasions, and traditional events. Especially people working in their traditional arts such as tea ceremonies and shrine priests and Buddhist monks wear kimonos more often.In addition, women in kimono can be seen, especially on coming of age day.
Mm-hmm. Right, okay, good. And also, like you said, people in traditional arts, which is common, so people in tea ceremony have flower arranging. And also people who work in Japanese-style restaurants and inns, right? So a lot of, nicer restaurants have, especially the ladies, wear kimono.And also, ryokan, or Japanese style inns, hot spring hotels, a lot of the staff wear kimono. Good. Okay. Good. All right. So I hope we're okay with this. In the last sentence in the model answer, they have the word, this expedited the spread of Western style clothes among ordinary people as well. This expedited means to speed up. So this sped up or speeded up the spread of Western style clothes.If you want to, neither of you said that, but just in case, I thought they're using a word that's not spoken too often, but it means to speed up. So this, quickened the spread of wearing Western-style clothes. So it should be something like this, quickened the spread of wearing Western-style clothes. Sounds a little more clear. Okay, or this sped up. Speeded up.
Speed it up.
I think Some people say sped. She's, yeah, they speed it up. Okay, good. The next question is about Toyotomi Hideyoshi. And the question is, do you think Toyotomi Hideyoshi is an important person in Japanese history, and why?
Yes, he's a very important person in Japanese history, because he was born as the son of a farmer, and however, he climbed up the ladder step by step, and finally, at the end of the 16th century, he unified the nation and conducted the extensive social reforms throughout the nation. And I think he's one of the key person to develop the many Japanese culture as it is today. And it was during his reign that extravagant culture, very flourish. Because Hideyoshi considered art was the symbol of power.
Okay.
Under his reign, many culture was greatly developed. Such as pictures, tea ceremonies, and architecture of many castles. Mm-hmm. So he favored enormous social events to show his power. So his culture became popular among the feudal lords and spread to the commoners.
Okay, good. All right. Let me have you answer. Tell me, do you think Toyotomi Hideyoshi is an important person in Japanese history, and why?
Yes, he is a very important person in Japanese history because one of the reasons is that he completed the he finished the battle inside Japan, succeeding Nobunaga, who was who fought against the other warriors in Japan, and he was almost successful to rule over the Japan. But Hideyoshi, after that, Hideyoshi conquered and ruled Japan completely, and the peace he brought in the complete peace to Japan. Mm. So in that sense, he is very important person. And then he invaded Korean Peninsula, although he failed. But at that time, he brought in or abducted Korean persons, potters. And these Korean developed the special pottery in Arima and Arita and Imari. This is the basis of Japanese gorgeous porcelain now.
Mm.
So,
okay.
Also, as she said, he urged promoted
Encouraged.
Encouraged. Yeah.
Promoted is okay. Promoted arts. Yeah.
Promoted arts.
Right. Okay. Good. That's fine. Good. Okay. Good. Yeah. We talked a lot about Hideyoshi. You might want to. I think you were trying to see after Nobunaga tried to unify the country after the Warring States period. Hideyoshi was more successful in unifying the country as the leader, because during the Warring States period there were lots of little like feudal domains, and nobody really ruled the country. It was like a chaos, right? And so during Oda Nobunaga started, and Hideyoshi more or less finished and was able to unify the country and put the country into peace. And what are some, just because you didn't answer and you can't answer everything, do you know what reforms he did? What I know, maybe other things, but two important reforms that he did.
Oh, yeah. One is he surveyed the farmer's land,
right?
And he could assign the rice should be paid to the lord,
Right.
So, the Shōen, which is a very old system, has collapsed. Shōen system, which has continued from about 1300
years
ago.
It collapsed.
It didn't work. It collapsed.
Well, okay. And what he put in, what I understand is like what we call in English, simply, it is a rice tax.
Rice tax. Yeah,
yeah.
Rice tax.
Based upon what, the size of the land?
Yes. The size. Yeah. Size of, not rice, size of the land. Yeah, rice. Yeah. Correct. Size of the land.
Right.
And
so
the quality of the land.
Right. There was also something interesting about the quality.
Yeah.
He also taxed not just the size, but the quality, as you said, yeah.
Quality and size.
And the size of the land. So then he kind of made an official, you know, rice tax system.
Yes. The other thing is something we call rice, katanagari.
Right.
He has taken away all sword and weapons from the farmers. So the farmers could not resist with weapon against the lords. At the same time, the farmers' position and or farmers' mission and samurai's mission was completely divided into two missions.
Two categories. Right.
Two classes.
Right. He took away the swords from the peasants, and so they wouldn't rebel, which is a very smart thing.
Yeah.
Because if the majority of people have swords, it might be dangerous for the leaders. So he took them away, and that's another reform. So that's why he's kind of famous for these two things.
Yes.
Okay. Good. I guess that was fine. Okay. What was there was a period of time called, what is it?
Azushi
Momoyama. What was that period like?
Oh, Azushi is a castle's name and also the name of a city. And Nobunaga built a castle in Azushi, and he. In the final stage, Nobunaga governed.
Governed. Okay, right. Okay.
Based on that area, that city.
Okay, based and from that city.
Based from that city. Momoyama is the same for Hideyoshi. Momoyama is the city, the name of city, and Hideyoshi governed Japan from based on that city.
From that city, right? So that's why they're, I guess, the names of their castles.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Good. All right. And I think isn't Hideyoshi was Osaka Castle eventually?
Yes. Also, he made.
Osaka Castle.
He built Osaka Castle.
Right.
Yes.
Okay, good. Okay, let's go to question three.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you can start again and I'll give you her a chance to speak. What is Tenno and what acts does he perform according to the Japanese Constitution? So simply put, what does the emperor do?
Emperor. In the present constitution, Tenno is called a symbol of Japan or unifying symbol, unification symbol.
Symbol of unification.
Symbol of unification.
Okay.
And he performs acts with advice and approval of the cabinet. So, for example, politically, he convenes and dissolves the diet. And also, he officially pronounces, announces the new law. And diplomatically, he meets and greets the important persons from foreign countries. And also, he gives the, for example, 文化勲章 or what you call that? Cultural
award or something?
Awards, to people.
Mm-hmm.
And also, he visits local places to meet local people and make communication with local people,
right,
and make some speeches.
Right, so make communicate, or maybe to come into contact with. He comes into contact with local people.
Comes in contact.
Right, mm-hmm. Well then communicate with is okay, but usually communicate is, I usually say, is usually the telephone or internet is communicate.
Oh, okay.
It's not a very personal expression.
Okay.
So we communicated means, you know, we corresponded, we you know, talked on the phone, we did email, we did fax. But face-to-face talk is, sometimes communication sounds cold, very formal. So he comes into contact with?
Comes.
So the emperor comes into contact with local people.
With local people.
Right. Or he can meet local people, and he can, you know, talk with local people. So it sounds a little more friendly.
Yeah, okay.
Communicate's okay, but to me it just has a little bit more of a more business-like.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Okay. Let me have her answer the same question. What is Tenno and what acts does he perform according to the Japanese constitution?
Tenno is the emperor of Japan. He was regarded as the living god until the end of World War II. But under the present constitution, he is the symbol of the state. Symbol of unification.
Okay, symbol of state. Symbol of unification. Sure. Okay.
And now he is considered to be a constitutional monarch, and he has mainly three functions. And the first one is political. He convenes and dissolves the diet and officially announces the new laws. The second law is diplomatic. He receives the state guests, important guest from overseas, and also he makes overseas visits. He has an important role in building up, promoting international friendship. The third one is ceremonial. He comes into contact with Japanese citizens through the attendance at various events, for example, facilities for the aged and or the handicapped, and occasionally he delivers the speeches at the events.
Sure, okay, good. All right, that's real good. Yeah, we're talking about he goes overseas. The expression we say, he makes courtesy visits.
Courtesy visits.
Yeah, I think it was C-O-U-R-T-E-S-Y. He makes courtesy visits to other, you know, countries and to other diplomats when he goes overseas. To other countries, right? Or to meet other country officials. So most of the time, it's not real business. It's not real politics. It's just like a friendly visit. So sometimes we say courtesy visit. Okay. You know, kind of. Okay, and also in this answer, you had no trouble. The very technical word of he convenes and dissolves the diet. That's the correct expression. There's nothing wrong. It's just very technical. It's only used for, I think, diet or court, The court is convened, the diet is convened means start. So if, you know, if you forget, just think of start and finish, or start and end. Okay. So he starts the diet, opens the diet is another way. He opens and closes. Okay. So he starts and ends the diet, he opens and closes.
The diet is a very common word in the world.
The diet is it a common word in the world? No, not really.
No, not really.
Right. So I don't know. Yeah, there. Each government calls their national assembly a different name. The America calls it Congress, and the UK and English they call, you know, Parliament. Okay, so they're all. There's a few different expressions used, but a few countries use the diet. If I'm not mistaken, it could be. I don't know why I think of Sweden, or
Sweden.
One of those countries. Some of them call it diet, but it's not very common.
Not common. In the examination, can I say the diet?
Sure, because that's
so they can understand the diet.
Oh well, yeah. Especially one of the things that's interesting is maybe, you know, foreign tourists from. Coming off the airplane might not know the word diet. They think of don't eat lots of food like I needed to go on the diet. But in the test, because that's what they expect you to say.
Oh, okay.
The test is in Japan. There's a Japanese person. There's another person that's, you know, not Japanese. And they usually will expect you to say certain terms. So don't be afraid to say that. Okay?
So I can say
sure. Diet. Yeah. There's a lot of Japanese expressions that probably most tourists wouldn't know. But some of them are. Okay, for the test.
Okay.
So diet is fine. Yeah, I think, as I say, some countries, a few use the diet. I don't know, Sweden or Finland. I don't think it's one of those countries. Their English name, they call it the diet.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Number four question is about the chonmage. Okay. Yeah, this is an interesting question. We'll just ask you the basic questions. Why was the chonmage hairstyle worn by the samurai?
That was because for better, samurai shaved the tops of the head of their heads, in order to reduce the heat under their heavy helmets, and they wore their hair straight on the side. When not wearing helmets, they pulled their side and back hair into the top knot. It originated in the Kamakura period, and it became a status symbol among Japanese society during the Edo period.
Okay, good. I know in the Meiji period that it became a law after, I think it was, 1874? 1872. It wasn't 1868. It was started, you know, 5 or 6, 7, 8 years later that they had to cut it off. Nobody could wear that. Why did they have to cut it off? Why did they have to shave? Cut it off.
Because after the Meiji Restoration, the new government promote to create a modern society, and hierarchy of four class and samurai status was abolished, and chonmage's hairstyle was banned by the law.
Okay. Can you say that again?
Okay.
I think it's okay. I just want to make sure. There's a point that is important. Okay. I think you got the point. But
after the Meiji Restoration, the new government promote to create a modern society, and Japan rapidly modernized and industrialized, and their former social class, such as the hierarchy, hierarchy was abolished, and that is why chonmage hairstyle was banned, and samurai have to cut off their heads.
Right. Okay. Right. So because during the Edo period, there was a very strict four class caste system, and in order to make everybody equal, after the Meiji Restoration, the samurai could not keep their status with top knots, and also they had to take away their swords, or they couldn't carry swords, right? Because there was no longer a status for samurai. Everybody was equal, technically. Okay, yeah, that's why they did that. Okay. I wish I remembered the year, but it was, I don't know, for some reason, 1872 or 1874 sticks in my mind. So around that time, I think it was because the samurai were not wanting to give up their status. So they decided they had to, and they did it, about 6, 7, 8 years later, something like that. Okay, good. Tell me, what is chomage? Well, how would you describe chomage?
It's a difficult question. The samurai, when samurai engaging in the battle, they become hot. So if they don't have chomage, it's the hairs and their helmets are attached. So no space between the hair and the helmets. Mm-hmm. So in order to avoid that bad condition, they shave the half of the hair, and also the half of the hair which have been grown wrong was tied and shaped to knot, top knot.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then, so the they could create the space between the helmet and the hair.
Right.
Allowing the air to circulate.
Right.
So it's more. They can feel more cool and. Present, even in the battle.
Right. Okay. Good. All right. So they wore that. Right. It's like it became like a cushion, right, to make air circulation. I don't know
but
if it works, but
I am very doubtful about this.
Answer. What do you? What do you have a theory?
I have no answer to that, but. I am now researching. This what I don't think this is correct.
Oh, you don't think it's correct? Okay, I don't know. All I know is this, but well, it sounds a little bit. You know, they shave the head, but if it comes in direct contact, it's going to be hot. So they needed a cushion. Uh-huh. You know, but shaving it.
But,
makes it cooler, you think, but then they have to put it on. So I'm not, again, yeah, that, yeah. Let us know if you find out about this.
Yeah. Do you know in Europe, there should have been the same situation.
Well, yeah, that was, yeah.
Helmet I understand. And hair. So what happened to them?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, the same thing. Because in Europe, I don't think people, they didn't shave their heads.
No.
They had just long hair over it, I guess, so they cut it.
So,
well, maybe Japanese swords felt different, or maybe the Japanese were more ingenious. Okay. Anyway, if you have another answer, let me know. If not, this is the answer. It sounds okay.
So I will let you know.
Okay, good. Okay, the next question, it asks about shogun. And I know that in the answer they've used that shogun is generally translated as generalissimo, but you know, generalissimo is Italian.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And yeah, and the only generalissimo I ever have heard of is Mussolini.
Oh.
So it's not a real common word. Although people, when they hear generalissimo, they think of Mussolini. So I, you know, sometimes the shogun is generally translated as a, you know, military leader.
Military leader.
Yeah. Okay. So military head of state, something like that also works.
Military leader.
Technically, the head of the military government. Also, so shogun is in Japan. In the case of Japan, as the shogun is the head of the military government. Which was why the Bakufu, say something like that, right?
In, so, in the dictionary, the Bakufu is translated into shogunate.
Shogunate, right, which is...
Is that correct?
Yeah, you could say, shogunate. But again, what is shogunate? Shogunate is like a government run by a military. Mm-hmm. So I think that's why the head of the military...
The common people in England or in America can understand shogunate?
Well, if they know history, but no, the average people probably wouldn't.
Wouldn't. So yes. The military leader or military government is better.
Is better, yeah. Military-run government or something like that.
Called back.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Government.
Good. Okay. In this answer, I think I'm a little bit more, I should be a little bit more clear, because there are basically two types of shogun in history. The first type were temporary, and then the second type were permanent. And I think it would be more clear if you use those words. So the first line here is originally a temporary title, and then later it developed into the permanent official permanent title given by the emperor to the administrative head of the country, the administrative military head of the country, something like that. That's all. So I would suggest you use temporary and permanent in your answer to make it clear.
Permanent title.
Right.
Permanent
title. Right, because Yoritomo was shogun, and then after that, he was the first permanent shogun. Because my understanding, the original ones were...
Permanent
shogun, okay. Right, the original ones... Like Sakanoue no Tamanamaru went out to the north, and then when he came back, and he was like shogun for that time.
Yes.
But after it, he wasn't shogun when he came back. So okay. So what is your answer for what is a shogun?
Shogun. The first shogun was Sakanoue no Tamanamaru, who was ordered by the emperor to conquer the people in northern part of Japan. And it was the title was very temporary one. So after he came back to Kyoto, he was no more shogun.
Mm-hmm. Was no longer shogun.
No longer shogun.
Okay.
Afterwards, the title of shogun became a permanent one. The first permanent shogun was Minamoto no Yoritomo, who opened the Kamakura military government.
Nope, who started maybe, opened.
Started, yeah, started. And then Ashikaga military government, and also Tokugawa military government. They were the Tokugawa, Ashikaga, and Yoritomo are the names of the shogun.
Permanent shoguns.
Permanent shoguns. Mm-hmm. And they are the shogun, the permanent shogun is a name of the military government, and
the head of the military government.
Head of the military government.
Okay.
And they were the emperor ordered has given the name to these people.
Right.
And under the order, the permanent shogun were allowed to govern or rule Japan.
Right. Okay. Good. All right, good. I know this was Sakanoe no Tamura Maro. Sounds to me it's a tongue twister. But I'm not, in history I looked and I'm not sure if he was the real first one. So one of the first. I don't know, I've read, do you think, you said the first one, but I thought there was his father before that or something, and then...
Yeah, might be, yeah.
Check. So one of the first, I think,
that?
Is safer. Yeah, I looked and tried to check. But it's not clear. But I don't think he was the first, but then it's not clear. Mm-hmm. So maybe one of the first temporary ones.
One of the first temporary shogun.
Right. Okay, good. How many shoguns were there, do you know?
How many shoguns?
Yeah.
In Tokugawa period, 15
that's
shoguns.
Easy.
Yeah. But I'm not sure in Ashikaga period, maybe 13 something.
I checked this also, and I think I've it's not really clear again, because when you add the permanent and temporary, the number is close to around 38 or 39, 37, depending,
including everything?
Yeah, including everything.
Kamakura, Ashikaga.
Yeah, if you look sometimes English books and then Japanese, they give a different number. So anyway, but yeah, I think including permanent and temporary, I think there's about in total maybe 37 to 8 to 39. Uh-huh. Okay. And
so
Tokugawa's
sure.
easy. Everyone knows it was 15.
15, yes.
Okay, good. Let me ask her the same question. What is a shogun?
It can be roughly said that and shogun was the practical ruler of Japan from the end of the 12th century through the mid-19th century. Shogun is usually translated into a military leader. And it was originally a temporary title given by the emperor to the commander-in-chief of an expeditionary army. And later, it became an official permanent title to their administrative head of administrative head of the country.
Okay.
The first permanent shogun was Minamoto no Yoritomo in the Kamakura period, and the last shogun was Tokugawa Yoshinobu in the Edo period.
Okay, good. Was Hideyoshi, Toyotomi, Shogun? Toyotomi Hideyoshi, was he a shogun?
If I remember correctly, he was assigned as our Taiko is a kind of a shogun. Kanpaku.
Well, something, yeah.
Thank you.
So, no. Okay. Yeah, he had some other title, but he wasn't a shogun, right? And Oda Nobunaga, who was also famous and powerful and influential in history, was also not a shogun, I believe. Do you know why?
Oh, Oda Nobunaga, expel the shogun in the 1570s.
Right, he expelled them, okay. The Ashikaga, here's some.
Ashikaga
right.
shogun.
But why was, everybody knows Tokugawa Ieyasu was a shogun.
Mm-hmm.
Why was he a shogun? Well, the emperor appointed him, but why could he become a shogun in Toyotomi Hideyoshi?
Strong power.
Oh, okay. I believe they had to show some lineage, some direct line descendant from the original shogun, no? That he had to show that he was a relative of Minamoto no Yoritomo or one of the Ashikaga or something. It also had to show some lineage, we call lineage, some hereditary line. And I think Hideyoshi was, a peasant, so he couldn't. And there was something Odunaba. So Tokugawa claims he was a relative. And I believe that's what I've read. So that's why the others weren't powerful, but then he could become a shogun because he had some past line from relative, some relation, kind of iffy. We say iffy, not real sure. But I thought that's what why he was able to become shogun. Okay. But the answer is Oda Nobunaga and Hideyoshi Toyotomi were not shogun. They had different titles. Okay?
Okay.
Yeah? Okay. Let's go on to number 6, which is probably one of the easiest questions today. It's tell me about the last shogun. Can you tell me about the last shogun?
Tokugawa Yoshinobu was the last shogun. He became the 15th shogun in 1866, but he ruled over the country only for 2 years. Because after Japan opened itself to Western countries, the anti-Tokugawa leaders were very afraid that Japan would be colonized by Western powers. So they tried to modernize and industrialize Japan by overthrowing the Tokugawa shogunate. And so that is why in 1867, Tokugawa Yoshinobu stepped down from the shogun and returned all his power to the emperor.
Hmm. Okay, good. Was he the 15th shogun?
He was the 15th shogun.
15th Tokugawa shogun.
15th Tokugawa shogun.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. A lot of people, this answer to me is not real clear. Yes, Tokugawa Yoshinobu was the 15th and the last shogun of the Tokugawa shogun, but Tokugawa Yoshinobu was the 15th Tokugawa shogun and the last shogun in Japan, which is more clear because, as we mentioned, I think there were 37, 8, 9 or shogun. So he wasn't the 15th shogun, he was the 15th Tokugawa shogun and the very last shogun in all of Japan. Okay, good. And can you tell me about the last shogun?
The last shogun was Tokugawa Yoshinobu. He was the 15th Tokugawa shogun and the last shogun and the last shogun. And he is a person during 19th century, late 19th.
Middle 19th
century.
Okay.
And after General Perry came to Japan, and there was a very big turmoil in Japan, and big domains in Japan resisted and fought against the shogunate, military leaders, which is Tokugawa. And he tried to avoid or stop that movement, but he finally failed because he and the shogunate was defeated by the domain's power. So finally, he returned the shogunate power to the emperor, and he retired. But he was not killed. He was 30 years later. He was raised to duke.
Oh, okay, duke. Okay.
And also selected as a member of the House of Peers. So he was happy after that.
Okay, right. And his shogunate was very short, right? I don't even know. You said 2 years? right?
Yes.
So roughly what, 1866 and 1867, right? So it was very short. Okay. Good. Okay, let's take a break because we have some other, you know, more questions, six more questions to go through. And these, again, do take time. So we'll take a break and then we'll come back and finish them. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, if we're ready, we'll continue. Question number 7 says, at the end of the Edo period, why did the shogun return his power to the emperor? Okay, and... yeah, oh, you can start. Why did the shogun return his power to the emperor?
In the 18th, no, in the 19th, late nine, late in the 19th.
19th century.
19th century. General Perry in the United States came to Japan and forced Japanese government to open Japan. And after that, finally, the government, military government, accepted that.
Mm-hmm.
There was a very big turmoil. Big domains such as Satsuma and Choshu resisted to the shogunate, a military government.
Okay.
And they said, they insisted the shogun's power should be returned to the emperor. And they made allies between Satsuma and Choshu. And together, they tried to overthrow the government.
Okay.
And finally, they are successful. So the shogun, Tokugawa Yoshinobu, gave up. And they had to return the power to the emperor. And that is why,
okay, that's why he returned his...
He returned.
Power to the emperor.
Power to the emperor.
Okay. Good. All right. Yeah. This is hard to explain, but yeah, I think that's okay. Good. Let me ask you the same question. Just we'll go on. At the end of the Edo period, why did the shogun return his power to the emperor?
That is because after the 2 centuries national isolation in Japan, in mid-19th centuries, Japan was eventually forced to open by Western countries, and the anti-Tokugawa leaders, including the imperial loyalists, the lower class samurai, they were very afraid that if the Tokugawa shogunate continued, that Japan would be colonized by Western powers. So they tried to modernize and industrialize Japan by overthrowing the Tokugawa shogunate, and finally the last shogun, the Tokugawa shogun, Yoshinobu, returned all the power to the emperor in 1867.
Okay, good. All right, that sounds good also. Just that after 2 centuries of national isolation.
2 centuries of national isolation.
Yeah, okay, good. Okay, let's go on to question 8. And it asks, how was Japan modernized after the Meiji Restoration?
After the Meiji Restoration, new government adopted many policies to create modern society, modern economy and society. And under the slogan number, enrich the country, strengthen the military, Japan imported many foreign technologies and the military draft system and educational system, and Japan rapidly very industrialized and modernized. Excuse me.
Okay, good. That's fine, yeah. The reason I just said is, how was Japan modernized after the Meiji Restoration? So Lex, after the Meiji Restoration was finished, how did Japan modernize? The question is kind of, you know, it's not real clear, but it's I know what they're trying to say. I would say, like, you know, once the Meiji Restoration started, how did Japan modernize? It's probably the more clear question. Right, after the Meiji Restoration started, how did Japan modernize? But how did Japan modernize after the Meiji Restoration, like after it finished? But anyway, sometimes the Meiji Restoration is just, you know, the restoring of power to the emperor, that one moment in time. And then sometimes, most of the time, it's referred to as a long time during the Meiji period when they were implementing all of these new, you know, technologies and introducing the industrialization and things like this. So that's why it's, what is the Meiji Restoration? Is it just a restoration of the power at the moment, or is it the period of time that these reforms and new things happened? Okay, but anyway, what they want you to answer is here. So basically what happened during the Meiji Restoration is what they want to know. Okay, I'll ask you the same question. How was Japan modernized during the Meiji Restoration? During the period of the Meiji Restoration?
In the Edo era, prior to the Meiji Restoration, there was a caste system, and also the political system was feudalism. So in the Meiji Restoration, the government officers abolished this caste system and also the feudalism, and it is for modernization according which matches the Western style.
Okay, so Japan's modernization maybe followed the Western style? Followed.
Followed, yeah. Followed Western modernization.
Okay.
And in order to achieve that, they raised three slogans, modern military system, modern political system, and prosperity of the nation.
Okay.
So they introduced a lot of technologies and invited some professors, scientists from the Europe and America, and also abolished many traditional system, or sometimes culture, even culture.
Yeah, that's probably, don't want to make your answer too long, because I know you could go for more, but that's probably good, and you've answered the question. Okay. In this question, and actually question number 9 are kind of almost the same thing, right? And the only thing I think in this answer number 8, and even in number 9, it's not real specific. It's more general. Japan modernized, Japan industrialized, Japan, you know, introduced new culture, but it doesn't give the specifics. You know, what new culture did Japan introduce? What kinds of industries did Japan do? How did Japan modernize? What did they do? They built bridges, they built roads, they built railroads. This is not in this, you know, answer number 8. And even number 9, there's not very much. It's kind of general. Your answer is okay if you don't mention all the specifics. I think it sounds better if you do. But if they ask you then, how did Japan modernize? What did it do? So then they want specifics. But what I'll do is I'll just ask question 9 and maybe give a few specific examples. I think it's a little, you know, more clear. For example, in question number 9, the answer given in the very last sentence, it says, you know, through abolishing the feudal system and introducing Western culture and political systems. But, you know, what kind of culture? What kind of political systems? These types of things would be interesting to know specifically. Okay? So question number 9 has like 3 important questions. It says, I heard the Meiji Restoration was very important in Japanese history. Why was it so important? How did it happen? And what changes did it bring to Japan?
Why is it so important? Okay. because the changes which have been made in this Meiji restoration is a basis of the current Japan prosperity.
Current Japan's prosperity.
Current Japan's prosperity.
Okay.
So it's very important. How it happened? Because the foreign countries, such as the USA, forced Japan to open Japan, and we had to do that. Otherwise, we would have been invaded and colonized by these countries. So we gave up and we opened Japan, and we developed made a modernization just like European countries.
Okay.
And the result of what happened. In this restoration, as I said, the Japanese government introduced many technologies and political and economical systems and education systems from European and American countries. And that's all.
Yeah, that's fine. Good. Okay. So you don't need to go into the specifics. That's actually gave a good answer. That covers it. Okay. Good. Let me ask you. Why was the Meiji Restoration so important? How did it happen, and what changes did it bring to Japan? Oh, I'm sorry, one more thing. You said current Japan, and actually probably I was thinking after I said current Japan's prosperity. Current Japan to me sounds a little funny. I don't know why, but present day.
Present day.
Sounds big. Present day Japan's prosperity.
Present day Japan's prosperity.
Yeah. Current Japan. You know, I don't know. Maybe we just don't say the expression current.
What, today's is okay?
Yeah, today's Japan, nowadays Japan. Probably my preference would be present day Japan is the best to me. Current Japan, current information, we say current news, but it's current sounds like recent maybe. Recent Japan's, it's also funny. We don't say that. Okay.
Present means longer.
Well, I don't know if it means longer, but it I don't know. It just has the expression of being now, where current means up to date, or, we don't say now Japan. So some words work, some words don't. The nuance sounds a little funny.
Okay.
Okay, sorry to interrupt you, but I was thinking of that. Okay. So tell me, what is your answer for this? Okay.
The Meiji Restoration took place in 1868, and it brought about drastic changes in politics, economics, and cultures. And the new government adopted the many policies to create a modern society and economy. And then Japan rapidly became modernized and industrialized. And for example, particularly transportation and communications was highly developed. And all the major cities were linked by telegraph.
Telegraph.
And the network of railroad was rapidly spread out. Mm-hmm. Feudal system was entirely abolished, and everybody became equally and no more hierarchy of the society.
Okay, everybody became equal. Did you say equal or equally?
Equal. I said equally.
Okay, everybody became equal. Yeah.
Became equal under the Lord. Mm-hmm. I think it can be said the major restoration resulted in avoid being colonized by Western powers, and the Meiji Restoration was the epoch-making event. This is the prologue to the modern age of Japanese society. Japan.
Good. Okay, one thing, the avoid. Can you say that sentence again? I need to fix the grammar for this. And this is one way of Japan's avoiding, I think you need to say.
Avoiding.
Yeah, try that sentence again. You have your notes there.
It can be said that the Meiji Restoration resulted in avoiding colonized.
Japan's, let's say, okay, it could be said that the Meiji Restoration avoided Japan's being colonized. It could be said that the Meiji Restoration avoided or prevented.
Prevented
Japan.
From being colonized.
Yeah, okay. That works.
It can be said that the Meiji Restoration prevented Japan from being colonized by Western powers.
Right. Good. That sounds fine. Okay. So, what were some of the specifics? I'll ask you. What were some of the specifics in how Japan modernized? What are some specific things the government did?
Government build up their infrastructure, such as transportation and communication. It was very highly developed.
Okay.
And as I mentioned, all major cities were linked by telegraph and the network of railroad. Was spread out.
Mm-hmm. What kind of industries did Japan introduce?
Introduced our
hard? Yeah, so this is what I mean, more real specific, like Japan started the steel industry and iron industry. Why?
To make their new
right, to make ships and to build railroads. They needed the tracks, right? The railroad tracks. They started what? Textiles, fabrics, I guess. And what else? The infrastructure, they built roads and they built what? Steel and concrete bridges instead of wood and rocks or something. Okay. And they started using fertilizer for farming. Okay. That I didn't hear about, okay. Right, so these are some of the things you could add. They also, introduced banking, modern banking. They introduced, in the political area, they introduced the constitution based on the Prussian constitution, which is a country that no longer exists, but was between Germany and Poland in that area. Which is now Germany and Poland. Okay, so these are the kind of specific things they did. And they started what? Compulsory education. They introduced a centralized army. Right. Okay, so this is why the Meiji Restoration was very important, and I think that's the key. So I think you answered that. So again, in your end, this is a long answer. So if you mention all of these specifics as well, it's too long. Just be prepared to know in your mind some of the specific examples that we just mentioned. Okay. Let's go to question 10, which is maybe a little easier. It's more closer history. Number 11 is a Heisei, so that's easy maybe. Number 10 says, what was the Showa period like after the end of World War II?
After World War II ended in 1945, Japan made a new start toward economic reconstruction as a modern, as a democratic country.
Okay.
And it was Japanese great efforts and support from other countries, Japan experienced considerable social reforms and was carried out. And from 1955 through 1973, Japan see their economic boom, miracle, economic boom.
Japan experienced that economic miracle.
Economic miracle was annual growth 10% on average.
Okay.
And post-war Japan features remarkable social changes, include more people living in nuclear family rather than their in extended family, and more love marriage rather than the arranged marriage.
Okay.
More opportunities for women.
Okay.
It's very important.
Okay. Good. All right. Good. Okay. Let's ask him. What was the Showa period like after the end of World War II?
At the Second World War, Japan, all cities in Japan were burned down. To the ash. So
to ashes. Yeah.
So we started from zero base. People had to work, my father's generation. People had to work hard. And as a result of that, they achieved the second biggest economic country in the world.
Okay, they succeed.
Finally.
Okay, they succeeded.
They succeeded.
Okay, in making Japan.
Making Japan the achieve
second. The. They succeeded in making Japan the second largest economy in the world. Is that okay?
They succeeded.
Huh? In making
in
Japan.
In making Japan. The second biggest world economic country in the world.
Good. Okay. Yeah.
And during that period, we introduced many technologies, and also the financing from the America and Europe. It was very helpful, and also in the constitution, we are inhibited to build up an army. So the American force helped us with the defense.
American what? For American army or American, American military?
Military. American military. We defensed us, defensed Japan for us.
Right, defends Japan for us.
Defends
okay.
for us. So we can focus on the economical growth. That is lucky for us. And now we are relatively prosperous.
Okay, right. Okay, good. All right, let's go on, okay, and the next question talks about the Heisei period, and the answer here in the first sentence starts with the bubble economy that formed at the end of the Showa period suddenly collapsed in 1991, which is true, but it doesn't really tell, you know, when did the Heisei period start, or when did the Showa period start? So the bubble economy that formed at the end of the Showa period suddenly collapsed in 1991. So was 1991 Showa or Heisei? By this sentence, we don't know. Right? The bubble economy that formed at the end of the Showa period suddenly collapsed in 1991. So was the 1991 the end of the Showa period, or is it the Heisei? So I think, yeah, it is Heisei, but I think you need to give a better time frame for your answer. So the bubble economy that formed at the end of the Showa period, and I think the Showa period ended in, is it 1989? Okay. So the bubble economy that formed at the end of the Showa period, which ended in 1989, suddenly collapsed in 1991 during the Heisei period, during the early Heisei period. So that makes it more specific. So then you have a time frame for this. So the bubble economy that formed during, or formed at the end of the Showa period, which was, which ended in 1989, suddenly collapsed in the 1991. In the early Heisei period. Okay, something like that to give a time frame to this answer. Because I'm not looking at this, I wasn't sure if, you know, listening, you would think, oh, is 1991 Showa or Heisei? Because it doesn't specifically say. Okay, so with that, I will let you answer this question how you like to answer it, because maybe you're not using this answer given in the book. The other thing here, just before I go on, is in the third line they have here non-collectible loans about the banks. And just to make that simple, and banks had huge bad debt. Banks had huge bad loans. Just something simple, you can make that there. However you want to say. Sometimes they say toxic loans is the current phrase. With this new economic crisis we have, everything now is toxic, like poisonous loan, toxic debt, things like this. Okay, with that, I'll let you answer how you want to. What is Japan like in the Heisei period?
Heisei period. Heisei began about 22 years ago, and just before Heisei, actually in Showa, the bubble economy occurred, and this was this collapsed all of a sudden at beginning of Heisei, which is about 22 years ago. And because of that, many bad things happened. Land prices, real estate prices fell down very sharply, and the consumer's price also decreased very sharply. And because of that, the banks, many banks, suffered from bad enormous amount of bad loans, so some of them were some of them collapsed, went into bankruptcy.
Okay.
So in the first 10 years of Heisei, our economic situation was very bad, stagnant. Even after that, it's so now. Well, these 10 years, even after the collapse of the bubble, we are still, our economy is stagnant.
Right, still struggling, right?
Still struggling, yeah. And, now, except for Lehman shocks, it's It's our GDP is varies. GDP's growth is a little bit stagnant or slow, but except for the Lehman shock, generally speaking, our economy is going up very slowly.
Right, or especially before the Lehman shock, it had kind of improved a little bit, and then the Lehman shock again threw everything in disarray.
Yeah.
Like everybody's economy.
But okay. Now it's going up.
Yeah, it's going up. Yeah, I think, you know, like I said, better than a year and a half ago.
Yeah.
Right, so now we have a little hope. Okay, let me ask you about Japan in the Heisei period. What is it like?
The Heisei period started in 1989 after Emperor Showa passed away. And the striking features of the Heisei period are economic chaos and natural disasters. And the first one, economic chaos, Japan experienced the economic bubble at the end of the Showa period, but suddenly it ended in 1991 in the early Heisei period, and it caused a long recession of Japan's economy. Then, on the other hand, not on the other hand, excuse me, in 1993 and 2004, there were two major large earthquakes in Kobe and Niigata prefectures. But Heisei period has also positive aspects. Japan hosted Nagano Winter Olympics and co-hosted the football games of the World Cup with South Korea. And these events, two events, encouraged people, Japanese people, having hopes for a bright future.
Okay. What do you think Japan can do to help the economy? What do you think the Japanese government can do to help the economy these days?
After the economic bubble ended, Japan is still struggling Japanese economy, and it's a long recession of the Japanese economy. But the last year, the new government started, and we Japanese have hopes their Japanese economy would be better, gradually better.
Okay.
Excuse me.
Maybe I'll ask him. Maybe he has some ideas before I... What do you think the government, because the economy is not very good, what do you think the government can do to help boost the economy?
The new government should be more aggressive and strategic about the how to concerning the economic growth. They should find the which industry should be encouraged to grow. For example, in my opinion, robotics,
okay,
space technology and ecology. These are our strong points in the world. These three are top runner in Japan, in the world. Mm-hmm. So they should, the government should make funding on these areas.
Okay, good. Yeah, that's a good. Let's look at the growth areas, right? And maybe some of the government spending has to be better regulated for what they spend money on. Some of the government money is spent on things that probably are not needed as much as other things, right? So they should, you know, refocus what they're spending money on, because some of the you know, the pension system and things like this are collapsing, and yet they're still, you know, spending money on things. So I think they need to, you know, fix some of the problems before they spend so much more. So that's maybe some idea. And okay, good. Let's go to the final question, and then we can have time to practice some other things and review some of these questions, okay? This is probably, again, an easy question. So I want to know about Japanese history. Which museum should I visit?
Oh, there are many museums in Japan, but if you stay in Tokyo, you should go to the Tokyo National Museum, in which you can find many archaeological objects and many old arts. You can trace back the Japanese history. I would say you should go to Kamakura City, Kyoto City, and Nara City, because they are themselves are the museum. There are many temples, shrines, and ruins. So naturally, if you walk around over there, you can find Japanese history.
Right. Okay, good. Okay, what do you think? I want to know about history. What museum do you suggest I visit?
If you are in Tokyo, I would recommend the Edo Tokyo Museum. It's located in Ryogoku on the JR Subline and Oedo Subway Line. It's about 2 minutes walk from the station. And this museum is well prepared for international visitors, and their exhibits are fully translated into several languages, and also audio guide available in many languages. And I think this museum has many artifacts and displays are from the Edo period. And the museum has models, so many of them very full size. Mm-hmm. And so it shows you what life was like the Edo period, so you can see and touch everything, so even children enjoy it.
Okay, good. Right, Tokyo Museum is really good. Mm-hmm. You have reproductions, as you said, and life-size reproductions and model reproductions, mm-hmm. So it's also good. He mentioned about going to the Tokyo National Museum. Where is that?
Tokyo National Museum was located in Ueno Park, within the Ueno Park, mm-hmm. And it's about 5 minutes walk from the JR Ueno station.
Right, so it's easy to get to. It's close, right? Mm-hmm. Good. Do you know of any? Maybe do you know of any other museums?
National History Museum.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I don't know the exact name of that. But if I remember correctly, it is located in Sakura City in Chiba Prefecture.
In Chiba.
If you are stayed in Chiba Prefecture, Chiba area, and you have enough time before your departure, so it's worth visiting this museum. This museum has a lot of artifacts and displays from different ages, different period.
Right. Okay. Right. I think it's called the National National Museum of History. Is that the name in English? I think. But in Sakura, right? So there's that one. There's also a couple of open. I'm not sure of the English name. I really forgot again. They're like open air museums, open air like housing museums. There's something Minzoku Inn or something, and one of them is in Kogane.
Oh yes.
And I think it's connected. You visit. I think it's connected to the Edo Tokyo Museum. So it's like it's the Edo Tokyo Open Air Housing Museum or something like that in English. But it's there, and it has actual Nagaya, the long houses from the Edo period, and some other period houses. And there's also another one, the same type, near... Our Meiji Mura is in Nikko, Nagoya. Nagoya, that's right. And there's also one in near Kawasaki, in a place, Ikuta, there's something like, I forget, but I think there's one there also that's an open-air museum with older buildings. So you could walk around outside and see, you know, old houses, old buildings. I've never been there, but there's also that, so good. Do you know where there's a museum to see ukiyo-e? Where can I see ukiyo-e?
Ukiyo-e. I believe you can see ukiyo-e in the Ueno National Museum. I believe. I'm not so sure about that.
And then, yeah, Tokyo National Museum in Ueno.
Tokyo National.
Yeah, they have, that's one place. They maybe depends on how much they have, but they do have some. Yeah. Okay. Anywhere else?
I'm not so sure.
She knows. No? Edo Tokyo, don't they have? Edo Tokyo Museum, I think, has some ukiyo-e. Right. So I think that they have that. Good. Okay. So pretty much we've covered the lesson. What I'd like to do is just quickly go over again a couple of these questions. Okay, so can you tell me what is shogun?
What is shogun? Shogun has two definitions. The one is temporal shogun. The first temporal shogun was one of the first temporal shogun was Sakanoue Tamuramaro, which was ordered by the emperor to conquer the Tohoku area people. And then there are many permanent shogun, which are military leaders in Japan. The emperor order them to govern Japan as a military leader. One of them, the first one is Minamoto no Yoritomo, and then Ashikaga Takauji, and then Tokugawa Ieyasu. So three shoguns three shoguns ruled Japan.
Well, three shogun, you want to say shogun eras?
Shogun eras, ruled Japan.
Right, there were three shogun eras.
Eras, three shogun
eras. Right. Yeah. Okay, yeah, that's fine, good. Let me practice with you. Do you think Toyotomi Hideyoshi is an important person in Japanese history?
Yes, he is a very important historical figure of Japanese history because he was born as the son of farmers, however, he stepped up the ladder, climbed up the ladder step by step, and he finally unified Japan in 1590s. And he conducted extensive social reforms in Japan. And the author, Hideyoshi is a very important person, key person to develop the Japanese culture as it is today, because Hideyoshi considered art as a symbol of power. He favored enormous social event to show his power. And its culture, such as the tea ceremonies, pictures, and architecture of many castles, were greatly developed under his reign. Mm.
Okay, good. Let's practice a Meiji. Yeah, thank you. Well, let's practice a Meiji restoration problem. What changes took place during the Meiji restoration?
What changes? The Meiji Restoration occurred because of the foreign pressure from mainly from the USA and also England and France. So they were very afraid of being invaded by these countries and colonized by these countries. So in order to avoid this kind of things, they urged themselves to become modernized, such as introduction of European technologies, military system, political system, economic system. So they are successful in doing that to a certain degree. Mm. That is why we are not, we could keep independent.
Right, okay, good. Let me ask you, can I ask you, what period in history are you interested in most?
Very interested in the Azuchi Momoyama period, and this period has three important major historical figures.
Figures.
Mm-hmm. Nobunaga, Hideyoshi, and Ieyasu, and they are one of the best loved figures in Japanese modern societies, and in this period the many powerful military leaders repeated the wars and tried to unify Japan. But these three figures succeeded.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
unifying Japan. And I have another reason why I'm interested in this period, mm-hmm. because many Japanese culture was greatly developed in this period, such as tea ceremony, pictures, and their architectures. Mm.
Okay, good. To you, what is the most important event in Japanese history?
The most important event in Japanese history? I think it's the Second World War. Because until that time, we followed European countries and American countries introducing a lot of technologies and economic and political system, but not yet complete, it's not yet perfect. By being defeated completely by the Allied forces, our land became ashes. So we could start from zero. Then our industrialization and economic and political system were completely reset and started. So in the very short period, I think we could achieve the present day's level. So the Second World War was the biggest event in Japan.
Okay, good. All right, good. I was asking about where I can see ukiyo-e. What is ukiyo-e?
Ukiyo-e is the woodblock painting developed during the Edo period. And typically features the landscape of Japan, Japanese landscape, small wrestlers, kabuki actors, and everyday life of the commoners. And they are still they can still can be enjoyed seeing. Excuse me. can be found in their historical museum.
Okay.
The nations.
All right. Who are some of the famous ukiyo-e painters?
There are some famous ukiyo-e painters. One of them is Hokusai Katsushika, and also a famous person is Hiroshige Ando. Katsushika Hokusai, Hokusai Katsushika, I think is the most famous person in the world as a Japanese.
As a Japanese painter, you mean? Artist?
Artist.
Okay.
Yeah, artist. He made a lot of woodblock paintings, but one of them, one series is we call it Fugaku Sanjuroke, which is 36 paintings, woodblock paintings, drawn with the background of Mount Fuji. So in each paintings, it has always Mount Fuji, small or big, or red or white, or so it depends, but it should have, it has the Mount Fuji. It's magnificent.
Right. Okay. Good. I think basically the Japanese name is long, but the English name is the 36 views of Mount Fuji.
36 views of Mount
Fuji. Yeah, I think that's what they call that. He made the 36 views of Mount Fuji. Okay. 36 views of Mount Fuji. Can you tell me about Mount Fuji?
Mount Fuji is the highest mountain of Japan, and it's located on the border between Shizuoka Prefecture and Yamanashi Prefecture, and it is 3,667 meters high.
How high?
Sorry, me no no. Okay. 3,776 meters high, and it is classified as an active volcano. It has a perfect cone-shaped, a very beautiful cone-shaped.
It's known cone-shape.
For cone-shape, and its beauty is known for, excuse me, at the very very beautiful mountains.
Okay, it's known as a very beautiful mountain. Okay.
Cone-shaped.
Yeah, there's a way. Be careful that people mix it up. It has a beautiful cone shape.
It has the beautiful cone shape.
It is very, what is it? It is beautifully cone-shaped. So people are mixing it up. So it is beautifully cone-shaped. It has a beautiful cone shape.
Cone shape, what's that?
Cone, C-O-N-E. It's like ice cream cone. A cone is something shaped like this. Not a pyramid, but a round pyramid. What is it, round pyramid? Not a triangle, but it's round, three-dimensional. So that's what a cone is, right? That's what we say, ice cream cone. So it is perfectly cone-shaped. It has a beautiful cone shape.
It has a beautiful cone shape.
Right.
Good. And the mountain has long been revered as a sacred mountain among Japanese.
Sir. Okay, good. Finished. Okay. All right. And next week, again, we have more questions. A lot of these questions deal with the Edo period. a lot of the Edo period type things. So it'll be interesting if you like Edo period history. Okay, so thank you for coming, and we'll see you next week.
Thank you very much.